They have these bonnets you put on your beard that trap in all the essential oil.
Teddy doesn't do that though.
I've considered getting that.
You'd be so hot. You'd be so hot in that, Brandon, you'd explode into a ball of flames.
Listen, it wouldn't be for glamour.
Like literally.
Yeah. You cannot sleep like that.
Brian, what's your routine?
Permit like every 2 weeks and forget about it the rest of the time.
Dude, my dad washes his hair with bar soap.
Oh wow.
That is his beauty routine.
Old fashioned.
Yeah.
John, what's your beauty routine?
What? No, nothing. I wake up, I roll over.
Yeah, look at it. There's no routine.
Wow.
L-O-L.
Oh, it stands for, you look fabulous.
It stands for lots of love, not laugh out loud, John.
I'll get back at him. Don't you worry about that.
That is the dorkiest mug I've ever seen.
I literally opened up the cover to pour some coffee, and I'm like, oh, here's this disgusting, terribly ugly mug that I've never gotten a chance to use. I'll put it on television tonight.
It's not even the Kindle Market mug. It's just grader built you the mug and painted it for you.
I think my sister-in-law had like a cup of Tito's vodka and bought this for me at a market one day. So here we are.
Nice. Well, if you don't know by now, now you know this is the jam. It is a fun Friday, and we're going to make it funky for you. So let's get into it. After 16 years in the Cubs broadcasting booth, Lynn Casper is headed to the South Side to pick up the radio mic for the White Sox. But it's no secret, not everyone is okay with this.
I'm going to have to earn the trust of some people who either hated my broadcasts or never watched or listened to me at all. And that's exciting too. And if we can, I don't know if we'll convert any fans over from the North to the South Side. I do take it very seriously that maybe a young person out there who hears our work and our broadcasts becomes a big White Sox fan or wants to be a big league broadcaster as a result of what I do. That's a win.
Okay, the Cubs tried to get him to stay, but to no avail. They put a sign up on the marquee that simply said, "Thank you, Lynn Casper," really classy. The team also wished him the best of luck on Twitter. So you see, John, if you just take notes from Lynn, you go from a Cubs fan to a Sox fan, your stock goes up.
By the way, the Cubs marquee has done a lot of thank yous this offseason to people that are leaving. Good for Len Casper. He's a great announcer, been with the Cubs 16 years. Yeah. Obviously, I'm a huge Cubs fan, but radio is always exciting. He says he wants to announce a World Series. When you're the TV guy, they let the national people do it. When you're the local radio guy, you get to call a World Series. So if the White Sox make it that far, we'll see. That's good for him.
Good for him. I just like Len. He's a good guy. He's always fun to listen to. You know, I tend to be a Cubs fan, but I like listening to Len. So I might tune into a Sox game a little bit more frequently.
Come on, South.
I'm not changing my allegiance, but I might tune in more frequently.
Yeah.
You say that now.
Not me. All right. A chilly but a very sunny weekend in Chicago. There's the forecast there. You might be a little stir crazy. It's a good time to get some fresh air. Time for Fresh Air Friday. You can snap some Instagrammable photos with the fam at the Jack Frost Winter Village in Goose Island. It's 2 acres of a Christmas explosion. Nothing says holidays more than trying to up your influencer game. That's the reason for the season. Or as Felicia will remind me, of course, that is not the reason for the season. So you can go to a lit Advent walk at Lincoln Park Presbyterian Church. That's nice. The interactive installation takes you through stages of Mary and Joseph's journey with reflection questions. What are you laughing at, Felicia?
Wait, where's Santa?
Well, because somebody has to save your souls for all this sinning that you guys do. And if it has to be me, I'm going to take that job with pride.
Okay. Oh,
we need a little church in this group.
Yes. Hey. I just asked where Santa was.
All right. Tomorrow is a great opportunity also to get some free Christmas trees on the South Side. This is happening in the Englewood neighborhood. The pastors of Englewood giving away 6 to 8 foot trees from noon to two. That's going down at the New Birth Church of God in Christ on West 69th Street. Masks and social distancing, of course, required. Every family deserves one, though, if that's how you're celebrating. And that's really cool to see.
Yeah, it makes it feel really good for the holidays. All right, when it comes to the COVID battle, Black and Latino communities are bearing more than their fair share of the burden. Something as simple as social distancing. Not, in fact, as simple as we think. Deanna Gutierrez is here now with the details. Dee.
Yeah, Amy, you just said it. Social distancing seems easy, seems kind of second nature, but for some, it's actually nearly impossible. Now, there's a new study that suggests that social distancing is actually a privilege, and it could mean the difference between life and death in some Chicago neighborhoods. Researchers looked at the ways people were infected with the virus. We have Dr. Molly Bryan and Dr. Janosa Jagai that thought the results would show the risks of public transportation, density, crowded homes as one of the top reasons why we are seeing so many Black and brown individuals dying from the virus, but it was actually something else, the internet access, that showed to prove more.
One of the big things that's important to think about in Chicago is the fact that a lot of these issues or struggles that people might experience with dealing with COVID tend to travel together in the same neighborhoods.
It's discouraging, but it's also something that can be intervened on, right? So if you live in a multi-generational household, there's only so much you can do about that. But if it's that you have a harder time navigating the shutdown because you didn't have the support or the resources or the infrastructure to be able to do that, then that's something that is fixable.
This spring, right? So both doctors were like, hey, we have to make sure that we take into consideration what has been done over the course of this year to help with that internet access. I mean, you have CPS schools giving computers to students and things like that. So they are going to take a look at these numbers again. But again, it's no doubt that we knew that Black and brown communities were going to be affected by COVID at a much higher rate.
Yeah, you really don't think about that internet access so much because we heard so much about CPS ensuring that students had internet access. But if you live in a family where you don't have a CPS or an elementary or middle school kid, you're not getting it from the city. Where are you getting it? That's just not available to you. And people have to go to work. They have to feed their families. And that means putting their families at risk.
And just adding to what you said, there's so many people that just frankly don't watch the news and are not paying attention like that and choose not to. It's unfortunate, but it is a fact.
Yeah. I also appreciate that the conversation is now shifting now that vaccines will be coming soon to equity and making sure there's accessibility, at least in some equal measures across different neighborhoods, different states. But this is a conversation that doesn't stop when we are done with COVID-19. This is a conversation right. That should just be getting started when we talk about healthcare and a bunch of other things in terms of equity and improving the lives of all Chicagoans and all people across this country.
Well said. And one more thing here, growing up in a Latino household, there's literally, guys, and I tell you this from experience, there's no way to social distance. Like we have, you know, la tía, right, that comes and stays over for a couple months, or you have la tía, hermana, or something like that. You know, we have our houses so full that it's just impossible for you to keep track on who goes to work, who does this and who does that, and still stay safe even in your own home.
Yeah.
Yeah, for sure. Thank you so much, Dee. All right, so today is National Cookie Day. I have a demonstration. I have something in a bag which I have not seen. It's a cookie apparently from Target that's getting a lot of attention. So the package includes three cookies. I'm going to look at this before I put it up.
Nope.
Okay, yeah, that's trouble. Okay, these three cookies make Santa Claus. So the top two, there's no problem with these two. But if you start to show the boots, you start to resemble what looks like something that well, there's a full screen image of it. Yeah, okay. Well, there it is. I don't see it maybe as much as other people are claiming to see it, but
yeah,
it's there.
Those boots
are a little. You okay with that? No problems?
I consider myself fairly dirty minded, and I go straight to just being Santa Claus.
Felicia, yeah, you're the dirtiest mind we got.
Now, you didn't wait go a minute, okay? no, I did not think that. I just saw some cookies that looked delicious, so I'll be eating those.
Yeah. It's not the same thing. I was like, how did John get the cookies?
Well, see, there's a lot I could say. There's a lot I won't say. There's certain details about the cookies themselves. Which, you know, I'm just actually going to stop right there, because if you really dive deep into this, there's some, you could go down the, yeah.
Just say twigs and berries. It's the holiday season.
Fair enough. It's the holiday season. I don't want to get fired right before Christmas. So we're going to wrap this one up.
Let's dive back into Dean. Hey, Dean.
Yeah.
Oh my gosh. I feel like we're going to bring back that snowman with the cocaine. Remember that sweater? That was scary.
Oh yeah.
Okay, guys. Yes. Let me put you on. Let me put you on with what's coming up next. Selena fans have been waiting for this. Como la flor, con tanto amor, me diste tú. Okay, maybe not me singing, but they do want to hear from Ricardo Chivara and the Selena Netflix series. All that is coming up after the break.
You may know him from playing Carlos Solis in Desperate Housewives. Now he is co-producing and taking on the iconic role of Selena's father in Selena, the series. We are so excited to have Ricardo Chivara join us today. Thank you so much for joining us.
Thanks for having me. I appreciate it.
This is such a major project, and we've been talking about it too, how excited so many people are to see this turn into a series. And her story was amazing, and then the movie was great, but it's been so long too.
Yeah, it's been like 25 years, and so I think what they wanted to kind of tell the whole story, you know, and that's kind of the beautiful thing about our series where, I mean, the series is called Selena, and of course, it's about her and her rise and her fame and her music and her legendary iconic status, but you also see the humble beginnings of where that all came from and how important the family plays a part. And you see fully realized characters in each and every one of these family members that make up the Quintanilla family.
Yeah. So do you feel a certain amount of pressure that comes with this role? Because, I mean, Selena, obviously important to the Latino community, a part of America's story. It's important to us as a country. I mean, is there a little weight to it?
Okay, so I come from South Texas. I'm from San Antonio. That's where I call home, and I've called that city my home for many years. She and I were born the same year, 4 months apart. Wow. We graduated high school the same time. So when I was in high school and in college, you know, taking classes, I'd open up our local paper there and I'd be reading about, you know, Selena had a concert here, Selena had a concert here. Or if I turned on our local news telecast, I'd be seeing her accepting awards at the Tejano Music Awards that was held at the Convention Center in San Antonio. So this story, this family story, her story as a musician is a part of the framework that, that is my young adulthood. So I know it very well. I understand its significance. And so I need to be very careful with it and to be very considerate about it, because I'm not just taking on a part in a story, but it's a story that is part of my identity and the community that I come from. So is there pressure? Probably. Do I feel it? No, because this is my job and I've been doing it for long enough that, you know, it's just get in and make sure you focus on the story. That's
it. He said, I got this.
I got this, yeah.
I got this. I'm not
I also knew that I had a lot of work to do. I wasn't going to take it lightly at all.
Well, and it's such so you play Abraham, her dad in the series. And I think for me watching the movie, just because that's not my family at all, it was so interesting to watch the dynamic between the father and the daughter and the father and the band. I mean, they were so tight. It was pretty cool to watch. Is that hard to portray on screen, or is that something you're also familiar with?
So, okay, here's another tidbit. I've never seen the movie.
Oh.
Coming from South Texas, it's just something that slipped by me. My father was a big Tejano Conjunto music fan. At the time that I was growing up, I wanted to have a flannel shirt on and be in Seattle listening to Nirvana and Mudhoney and all kinds of other bands. But I have grown to have an appreciation for Tejano and Conjunto music over the years. And I always had an appreciation for the story and the significance of Selena in our community.
Well, we are certainly looking forward to that. You have to let Amy and myself have our moment, because we also know you as Carlos Solis, and we enjoyed you playing that character in Desperate Housewives. Look at Amy. Yeah, do you have a favorite moment? That was a huge deal. Do you have a favorite moment from that show?
You know, I mean, for me, it was, I loved working with the other guys. Like, all the guys, we got along so well, you know. I mean, we really, really did. And I think it's because we were all, you know, kind of in the same position from storyline to storyline.
Yeah.
But, you know, I mean, you know, my relationship with Eva was always wonderful during those 8 years. We worked very well together. Our storylines, I think we always had fun. And also the crew, like our crew on that show is one of the most amazing crews that I ever got the opportunity to work with. I still am friends with a lot of them to this day, like I like communicating on a weekly basis with some of them, even a daily basis. So yeah.
Hey guys, you can keep up with Ricardo on social media, of course, and be sure to check out Selena. The series is out today on Netflix.
All right, she plays Jax on the hit CW series Pandora. Now, Priscilla Quintana sits down with me to talk about what it takes to put on this massive sci-fi epic on the CW. More of that when we come back. Stay right there. Welcome back. Priscilla Quintana has built quite a fan base as the star of CW's sci-fi epic called Pandora. I had a chance to chat with the actress about filming around the world during the global pandemic and the cool technology behind the show.
I have to tell Xander. Do you even know where he is?
The child is not Captain Duval's, Jax.
What? No, of course he is. He has to be.
I'm afraid there's no biological father.
How is that possible?
So let's talk about, you know, this show, Pandora. Congratulations, season 2, going really strong right now. But it was filmed during this weird time, right? COVID-19. What's it been like filming a show in a whole pandemic, also overseas, Bulgaria, right?
Yes, in Bulgaria, which is about a 16 and a half hour travel day. So it's quite far, but I think that we all thought it was going to be so much scarier than it was. You know, I was talking to my agents and we were like, should we do this? Is it safe? Is it responsible? And we all eventually, you know, went over the protocols that they were going to be going through on set as far as COVID safety. And it ended up not being that scary at all. On set, we had to be very, very careful. It was different. It's so weird because it's the same crew from season 1. So I'm used to seeing their beautiful smiles in the morning and hugging my makeup artist. And you know what I mean? Yeah. And we couldn't do that. So it was very strange to see everyone with the masks and the goggles and the gloves. And their, have you seen Monsters, Inc.? It kind of reminded me of like hazmat suits.
Where they get one sock on them and they got to bring in a whole crew.
Exactly, the exact reference. Yeah, so I felt like Boo, and everyone was like touching me like with a 10-foot pole, basically.
It appears that you are pregnant with your own clone, and the gestation is so rapidly accelerated that you're going through 9 months of pregnancy in less than a week.
So you play Jax, who is a really strong woman character in this series. What do you like most about playing Jax?
I love doing stunts and I love doing hand-to-hand combat and fight scenes. Whoa. And she gets to do a lot of that. And I almost always do my own. Sometimes I have a stunt double because she's just trained and actually knows what she's doing. But for the most part, they do let me do my own stunts. So that's definitely my favorite part about playing Jax, for sure. I don't ever want to work on a show where I'm not kicking people's butts again. So fun.
I love that. It seems really exhilarating. And one of the unique things about this show and any sci-fi show, you're filming a lot with green screens and stuff that like you can't really actually see. What is that experience like for you as an actress?
So freaking weird.
I bet.
Like, it is just the most bizarre, strange thing ever. There was a portion where Oliver and I, we had to imagine that we're looking at the most beautiful planet in the world. And they gave us like a green screen and like one strand of Christmas lights. And they're like, just imagine. And this is like day one. And we're like, oh my God, what are we in for? But as it went on, it definitely got easier. And I forgot which actor said this. He's an icon. His name is slipping me right now. But he said that the purest form of acting is green screen acting, because you have nothing that you're acting with, really. So it's really just all about imagination and creating this world in your head and hoping the final product looks good.
And you can catch Pandora Sundays on CW26 to see how that product turns out. John, over to you.
Thank you. So new world record alert. Her name is Simone Williams. She's from Brooklyn. And her afro has now been officially registered and certified as the biggest in the world. So take a look at this thing. This is it's really actually gorgeous. It's
gorgeous. Wow.
Right? And if you measure that all the way around, it's 4 feet, 10 inches in circumference, which bests the old world record by about 6 inches. Took her 9 years to grow. She said she kind of stopped going to the salon because, first of all, it saved her cash. And obviously now she's celebrating her natural hair. She says, I can't even believe this, and I'm glad we're seeing this image. It says it takes her 6 hours to dry her hair.
No.
Yikes.
Seems insane.
6 hours?
Wait a second.
Yeah, hold on. Help us out here.
I got my picks. How many more? How many more feet? How many more feet do you think I have to go? How much more do you think?
You got something. I think I can do that for sure.
I have a really good hair
You used to have bigger hair. You used to be closer to that.
Yeah. Yeah.
At the end of the show, Felicia, you could be double your size right now, I bet.
Start untangling, girl.
Yeah. I would like to know this woman's Instagram just to talk to her, just to say, hey, how you doing?
Oh, I see.
She doesn't want to know you. She doesn't want to know.
Okay. We got to go to break, oddly enough. Yeah, we'll be right back.
I'm going to search for her on Instagram right now.
Brandon always setting us up.
Oh. Here we go. Wait. Put me in, coach. I'm ready to play.
You're making fun of Brandon's look tonight.
Hey.
By the way, it was weird coach. That I read the afro story. Yeah. I don't know. I felt like, I don't know.
What? I just want to say, I think I did a good job singing on Wednesday. Oh, and I sang tonight too.
Freaky Friday.
Oh, there we go.
Freaky Friday. I like
Where are we going, girl? If it wasn't a quarantine Friday, Felicia, what would you be doing? Where would you be going tonight? Where'd you be dancing?
Oh my goodness. I would probably be on someone's table dancing somewhere. I'm going all in on my Friday nights when I get out of quarantine.
Let me get my wallet out, see if I got any singles for that, girl. hold on. No, I only got leggings for you. Boom, boom, boom.
Just buy me a couple cocktails and some appetizers, because you can't afford me, honey.
Friday. Oh, thankfully someone else has already taken you.
Together as husband and wife?
Yep, just me and you.
Well, don't just stand there, son-in-law. Let me eat.
Where's my sweet son?
You need to use psychology. Dr. Phil, Oprah, mind games, Black Ops.
All of us.
Mama, can you pass me a piece of turkey?
Which one?
Well, you just saw a clip from the new film, Christmas Dilemma. Friend of the show and the film's director, Essence Atkins, joins us now to chat more and preview the upcoming movie. Welcome, Essence. Thank you for being here. Congratulations. This is your directorial debut, right?
It is. Thank you so much. I really appreciate it.
Yeah. So Christmas Dilemma, where did the idea for this movie come from? How did we get here?
Well, TV One had a script, a wonderful script, and the production company, Swirl Films, I've actually done a number of productions of theirs prior to this, so as an actress in front of the camera. So I did a movie called Coins for Christmas and Coins for Love and My Other Mother, and I thought when my phone rang and I saw who it was, that's what they were calling about, me acting in something, doing perhaps a third installment to the Coin series. And they were like, how would you feel about directing a Christmas movie for us? And I said, terrified.
How does it differ, you know, directing and acting? I mean, I know that there are a lot of huge differences, but what was the big thing that you had to shift?
On a positive note, the big thing was I got to be on set all day and nobody cared about what I looked like. So there was like no hair and makeup team kind of swirling around. So that was a lovely thing to be able to be creative. But really, you know, a director's job is really about having the vision of what the story is and then allowing people to execute your vision and collaborating with them and then assembling it once you have all the pieces, right? Because everyone is responsible for a different aspect of the storytelling, and then ultimately it's my job to assemble it. So it was great. I have strong opinions and I love to collaborate. So I think those are like great ingredients to be a director. And I love actors and I love storytelling.
We want to know. Okay, so we know you from Half and Half. We know you from Smart Guy. And now these shows are coming back to Netflix. How do you feel about that? I'm excited as a fan.
It's nice to have those intersections in your life, but then to make a permanent connection and to have permanent friendships and good feelings and wanting to collaborate again. I mean, Marlon the sitcom, not Marlon the man, is a perfect example of that. I've worked with Marlon Wayans when we did Marlon the sitcom, and that was my fifth collaboration with him. So I am very proud of the longevity of my career, but also, to be honest, the repeat business, the fact that people continue to want to work with me over and over again. And that's really how Christmas Dilemma happened.
What's next? I know you mentioned that there is more talks of directing. Anything that you haven't done?
I don't want to say no, because there's plenty I haven't done, but I'm definitely going to direct again. And then I'm actually going to act. I'm leaving tomorrow for Atlanta. I'll be working on the second season of BET's First Wives Club. So I'm going to do a recurring character on that this season. So I'm really excited about working with those ladies and collaborating and making new friends.
Hey, you guys, support our sis. Christmas Dilemma premieres this Sunday on TV One. For more info, head to TV1.tv. Thanks, Essence.
Ryland James, a platinum-selling Canadian singer-songwriter, rising the charts, sort of meteoric fashion right now. He's got a new Christmas album, too. We'll get to that in a moment. Ryland, thanks for joining us today.
Thanks for having me on.
Your sound is so good. It crosses over so many different genres. People have kind of compared you to Sam Smith, other big names. That's got to be kind of humbling.
Yeah, totally. I mean, it's still surreal to think about, but I'm honored to be compared.
Were you born with a microphone, basically?
Yeah, well, kind of. My family, they're very musical. I grew up in like a very gospel kind of household music. So I was 10 when I started to think I could do it as a career. So not quite when I was born, but almost.
I was wondering about the gospel roots because there is a lot of soul in your music.
Yeah, totally. My grandma, she played gospel piano growing up. She didn't know how to read music. She didn't really understand theory. She just played from ear. And so I was always surrounded by that. And every song that I'd sing, she'd put like that twist on it. I'd stand at the piano and sing with her. So that's where the roots came from.
Okay, so like I listened to Mariah Carey on repeat, her Christmas song. I need new Christmas music in my life. Everyone's got albums, so why should we focus on your new Christmas album?
I think I tried to make it as like organic as possible. I tried to make it as true to myself as possible. And you know, exactly. I think like everyone was thinking this year, I just wanted to put something out that would make people happy, that would make people, you know, feel good over this holiday season, especially, you know, with restrictions and things.
You can keep up with Ryland on Instagram, YouTube. He's got some great videos as well. And the new holiday album, A Little Christmas, available at RylandJamesMusic.com. He's going to perform it in a little bit.
We showed you this photo of three director's chairs with the initials MC, AG, and JH. So we finally know what it's for, a new song, part of Mariah Carey's Christmas special. Everyone's talking about the whistle tones from Mariah Carey and AG, Ariana Grande. The JH was not for John Hanson. We all had our fingers crossed, but our other real Chicagoan, Jennifer Hudson. I mean, I'm excited to hear the whole song, but I find like Ariana Grande is kind of like, I don't know, does she can stand up with Mariah Carey and Jennifer Hudson?
Oh no, Ariana Grande has a voice, 100%. However, it's like three powerhouse voice people, they're gonna all be overpowering each other. So it still doesn't work, because it's too much goodness.
Well, they pause for each other. You know, like not like us, we talk over each other. Maybe they pause.
When Mariah and Ariana were singing together, like, oh my God, you don't get two sopranos in that same thing. They needed some J-Hud in there too. I don't often put myself in these shoes, but if I were Mariah Carey's financial advisor, I'd be saying, look, you need to diversify your calendar here because she's getting so much money in November and December from her Christmas music. She needs to come up with some Easter songs. Mariah Carey, she needs to come up with some summer songs because all of her money. Yeah, no, it's all coming in November, December. She need to diversify those accounts.
That's cute. That's
funny. Sure, she's financially okay.
By the way, when Felicia says that's cute, that's funny, that means we're moving on. And because she didn't find it all that funny, which is fine. It wasn't that good of a joke, but I was proud of it. Okay, this ain't the only Christmas tree in my house. I got some decorating last week, and here's Enrique, really impressed with the tree. I know the stairs. I decorated the little lights, you know, and I love Christmas trees. I love Christmas. I love all things about it. And our tree actually turned out pretty darn good. We got one tilted photo there at the end of it. It's a little tilted, but I fixed it. Look at that. I was very excited for my new. Well, I have a really exposed thing, and there's Enrique one more time. But guess what? You can show off your holiday lights, your Christmas trees, or whatever you need to do. Go to cw26chicago.com. Enter there. We're partnering with ComEd's Energy Efficient Program to bring you holiday lights, and we're going to feature those on air and throughout social media stuff all through the holiday season.
Why aren't they pulling me up? I'm doing the move, and they're not pulling me up. There we go. Okay, so you know that most people don't like their name and cancel culture in the same sentence, Did I get that out? Yes. Okay, but maybe a Black Panther star is canceled. I don't know. We're going to talk about it in News You Need to Know coming up after this. Uh-oh.
Okay. I was like, are we on? Okay.
Okay.
I think Brian normally has like a shortcut button. That you can...
Good evening, everyone. I'm Diana Gutierrez with the news that you need to know. The rush is on. Chicago area health officials are getting ready to administer the COVID-19 vaccine when, of course, it's safe to do so. In the burbs, they're planning a sort of drive-through system in the city. Since it's a little bit more congested, there are some talks about having them done at clinics, doctor's offices, and, of course, pharmacies. Either way, we're going to have to wait a little bit because of those federal guidelines on who is getting it first. In Western Michigan, a senior pastor is actually encouraging his congregation to catch the Rona. He says, get it over with. Several members of his family got it and recovered. In fact, he says the flu was worse. The House approved a bill to decriminalize marijuana and tax it at the federal level. They say it's a way to help the war on drugs with expungement and other resources that can become available. The opposing side, which is majority Republicans, mocked the move, saying we have to worry about what's going on right now, like the pandemic, but the Dems say they could do both. And former Alderman Edward Verdoyelik, there we go, was sentenced to a year and a half in federal prison. He had pleaded guilty to tax evasion, and he's also involved in a bid to make millions of dollars from a state settlement with tobacco companies. Now, the hearing is in 3 months to see when he will actually have to report to prison. The judge had said that he is not going to send him to prison during COVID. So we're going to see, keep an eye on that to see how that goes. And Black Panther star Letitia Wright retweeted a video showing kind of anti-vaccination vibes, and people got mad, like mad. Okay. The YouTube video, which by the way is like 69 minutes, is from On the Table, and it talks about the safeness, the effectiveness of the COVID vaccine. Now, people went off saying, hey, you need to stop putting your fans at risk. She has then, since then, took down the tweet and said, quote, my intention was not to hurt anyone. My only intention of posting the video was it raised my concerns with what the vaccine contains and what we are putting in our bodies, nothing else. And she also mentioned, of course, this canceled culture, right? You can't say anything without, you know, being worried about being canceled. And that was her opinion.
You know, listen, I don't disagree with her start to finish if you follow her entire thread. She was literally questioning, what are we putting in our bodies? How is it going to affect me? Not saying she wasn't going to get it. However, that's not how social media works, and she should know that. That's where her responsibility lies. Because if you put some stuff out there, but not in a full context, where people don't watch an hour-long video clip, they're only going to get part of it. And so she needs to be a little bit smarter about how she posts. But in her whole message, I don't think anything she did was wrong, and she should not be canceled.
Yeah, no, definitely not cancel. Whether she believes it or not, retracts it or not, I mean, you should be, that's the issue with cancel culture. But I think she has to, as you kind of said, Amy, like she has to take her platform seriously and understand that you have a responsibility, especially when you step out there and talk about such a sensitive topic right now that is literally affecting the world. But of course, she's entitled to her own opinion.
Yeah, I'm taking a much harder line on this one, guys. The video that she tweeted included language such as, I don't understand vaccines medically, but no, stop there. You don't understand vaccines. You aren't a scientist. And I realized that wasn't her saying that. That was the video, but you don't get to spread that. And then later on, she went on to say, she stood by her decision saying, just using my own mind to think, which I'm free to do. Yeah, of course you are, but you're talking about science. You're not a scientist. So do not bring that opinion to the table.
And I agree with you. But if you think about it, Jen, we have all had this exact same conversation, the three of us, right? And we've all questioned, like, I don't know, is it safe? You know, but we questioned it amongst ourselves. We didn't put it out there. Because you're allowed to have those questions. And you should be asking an official, somebody who knows the answer to these questions. You can't put the questions out there on a platform with all the viewers she has and not expect some backlash. It's irresponsible. Well, but she's allowed to have those opinions or those questions.
I'm just concerned with all the people that are going to follow along in her line of thinking and not do their own research. Because you guys know social media is kind of how everyone gets their information nowadays. So if someone says, hey, I don't believe in the COVID-19 vaccine or any vaccine in general, I mean, what's so wrong about me saying, hey, me either, just because I'm a fan?
That's the real thing. The real answer is do your own research.
Right.
Yeah, I just hate someone that like lights a match, throws it on a pile of gasoline, and then goes, I'm entitled to do this. Like, yes, you are, but it's dangerous, and there's a fire over there, and we have to put it out. That's all I'm saying.
Okay. That's a good point. We'll be right back.
So I was so worried about 3 minutes being like super long. It was a little long for the whole. Okay, time for trending, but when Chris is on assignment, it turns into trending hot takes. Woo! All right, the gang is all here. It's hot. It's steamy. We're not taking our temperatures here today because we'd be out of the charts. Okay, we have the whole gang here. Yep. All right, so I'll give you a trending story. Each of you got a quick little hot take. Y'all ready to go? Okay.
Yep.
All right. Speaking of hot, it was candle day today at Bed Bath & Beyond. Massive sales in stores and people were going crazy. They sold out of their candles in just a few hours. Candle day, what do you think? Amy?
It's Blood Bath & Beyond. They raise all the prices and give you a 20% coupon, so what's the point of shopping there?
Ooh, Brandon. Oh.
That's right along the lines. I was thinking they spiked the prices just to make a pretend sale. All this, and you could have just gone to shop local and help some local businesses with their candles.
Oh, yeah. You had to go there.
Speaking of local, let me introduce you to the Edified Shop, a Black-owned, female-owned company that makes candles. Get your candles, guys.
Deanna.
I just hate myself for paying $24 for a candle. That's all I have to say.
Oh, that's cold, but I'm going with 12 bucks. Amy. Amy gets the hottest take for Blood Bath & Beyond. That was really good. Okay, here we go. Hot take number two. Here we go. A Hawaiian couple was banned for United Airlines forever after they knowingly boarded a flight after they tested positive for COVID. They were also charged with reckless endangerment. Deanna, hot take.
Oh my gosh, there is no one I would rather use my mom's chancla on across the face than these people.
That's awesome. Felicia.
Well, if my mama had a chunk, I'd be doing the same thing, dummy.
Brandon.
This is what happens when you have a COVID-19 honor system. We should have shut down air travel, and this wouldn't happen.
Wow. Okay, Amy.
Stupid gets what stupid does.
Ooh, that's pretty good, but I'm going with the chancla or whatever. What was that, Deanna?
It's a chancla.
Chancla.
Okay, really quickly, this one's crazy. There's a cat fight, a little cat fight brewing in Lake County. Basically, a cat went missing 9 years ago. Someone found it late last year. They said, oh, I'll give you back your cat, but they didn't. Who gets the cat? The person that lost it 9 years ago or the person that found it last year? Brandon, hot take.
Finders keepers, but who wants to keep a cat anyway? They are easily the worst house pet in the entire world. Facts.
Deanna!
Yeah, I don't really care about this story. If it has to do with cats, not interested.
Amy!
I can't come up with anything appropriate for television.
Felicia!
Hey, let the cat decide. I know the legal answer. Let the cat decide.
I will say, it was missing for 8 years. Maybe the cat just didn't want to be in anybody's home.
Side note, don't lost your dog.
We'll be back after this.
Sorry, they're doing work downstairs. That's a drill.
Are they destroying your house around you? What is happening?
A statement under false pretenses. I think we got to go back and do it because it's invalid. It doesn't count.
All right, so I messed up. So the candle tale was not Bed Bath & Beyond. We will have you happily as a sponsor if you'd like Bed Bath & Beyond. It was Bath & Body Works. I read the story completely wrong. Thank you, Brian. I wrote it completely wrong. That is my fault. Okay.
I still win, though.
Yes, you still win. All right, earlier I had a chance to talk with singer-songwriter Ryland James about his newly released Christmas album. It's called A Little Christmas. And here he is now singing the title track. Let's take it away, Ryland.
Got the heart of St. Nicholas, but the spirit of Scrooge. Can't hear sleigh bells ringing when you're singing the blues. Silent night in, while you're hiding with a fire built for two. When the flame's slowly dying, got a light you can use. I can make you believe underneath this starry tree. We can build new memories. All we need is you and me. Let's rewind it to the time when we lost. little Christmas can do. Make your heart grow 3 sizes with your eyes all aglow. You'll be giving out kisses when there's no mistletoe. It's exciting, come alive when you learn a thing or two. Now you're showing what a little Christmas can do. I can make you believe underneath this starry tree. We can build new memories. All we need is you and me. Let's rewind it to the time when we lost that part of you. Let me show you. Oh, oh, what a little Christmas. Let me into the dreams that you keep in your head. We can stay there in blankets or cozy in bed. Only gift that I need is the time that we spend. Oh, oh, darling, I can make you believe underneath this starry tree. We can build new memories. All we need is you and me. Let's rewind it to the time when we lost that part of you. Let me show you, oh, oh, what a little Christmas can.